Dr. Clark, who we interviewed in jail at the Surrey Pretrial Centre. He returned to British Columbia in February 1997 to represent his native clients in this trial. Immediately he arrived at Vancouver International Airport, he was arrested and then jailed for contempt of court. Throughout this interview, Dr. Clark made startling revelations and serious claims against the ethics and honesty of the police, judges, and lawyers in British Columbia.
Really, what we're talking about here is the same principle as that enunciated by Magna Carta, that no person is above the law. King John was not above the law. Therefore, it follows that the king's courts, the king's legislature, that if the king himself is not above the law in 1215, no institution within the human society is above the law. Essentially, what the judges are saying is that they are above the law. There is only one possibility, which is that the truth must come out. That is, we must sort out what existing law is, and then if we have a state of facts which makes existing law not appropriate to the political realities and necessities of the day, then one amends the law. But until the law is amended, it must be respected.
The Gustafsen Lake standoff in the summer of 1995 was the most expensive police operation in British Columbia history, and the resulting trial of 18 defendants is projected to surpass this amount. Why such an expenditure and massive deployment of force over a few acres in the remote area of Canada? Why did the police exert so much effort over a minute parcel of inaccessible land in a vast continent? Why pick on campers who were simply practicing a native spiritual custom? Why does it appear that the government, police, and judicial system have collaborated in fabricating contrived charges? Here is Bill Lightbound, a Kootenai elder and supporter of traditional native views.
Just so happens that we've got enough evidence and material that has come out in this court process to show very well that there definitely is and was and is still is an ongoing conspiracy to ignore, deny, and to put down the legal argument and the legal position of the Aboriginal nations in this country.
I see myself as standard issue, ordinary Canadian who was brought up to tell the truth, to believe in honesty. I had a widowed mother. She was a poor but honest type, but took a lot of pride in it. She worked as a secretary. And that's just, to me there's no option, there's no choice. It is inconceivable to me that anybody could know what I know and turn their back on it.
Here is John Splitting the Sky Hill, who played an important role in preventing the slaughter of natives.
Lyle James had roughly 2,000 head of cattle. What happened from the onset there was just that these cows would continue to come in the Sundance Grounds areas, and they had to be chased out all the time. People were chasing them out, about hundreds, to get them out of there. And the cows would eventually go within the sacred grounds, and they would defecate on the grounds while people were trying to Sundance and stuff. And so it was constant disruption for the ceremony, because during that time, the 4 days of fasting, you have to fast, completely abstain from food, from water, and making yourself preparations 4 days before you enter the arbor, and then you have a complete dry fast, no food, water, and you dance all day into the sun seeking visions. And you're seeking visions in order to be received by the ancestors from the world of spirit to give you direction in this life to understand what your purpose is and what your job is, and how you can become a better and a stronger human being, and to understand the law between this world and the next. But you can't do that. You can't fulfill your spiritual commitments when you're being, you know, when you're being accosted, you know, basically, you know, by cows coming through, and you're having to get up and have to chase the cows out. Everything during that time has to be quiet and peaceful, and you have to put all of your concentration into the power of prayer, and to understand that it's between you and the Great Spirit and the spirits of the ancestral world that you're wishing, you're asking them for permission to leave this body and go into the world of spirit, to understand who you are and to understand that there's a duality in life, that's matter and spirit, physical and spirit. And you're seeking knowledge of yourself and your relation, your symbiotic relationship between you and the Creator, between you and the ancestral world, the world of spirit. So in doing that, in seeking the visions, you have to have be a very peaceful mind, and you can't be distracted. So given the fact that these cows were a major distraction, and they were defecating on sacred grounds that have been blessed by the medicine men, given that was the situation, a few of us decided to put up a fence before the actual Sundance would happen. So we put up right alongside of an old fence line that was there. We put up a post for about a quarter mile from one end of the arbor, the sacred Sundance arbor, all the way down to the lake. And I guess at that time, a couple of Lyle James's cowhands saw that as a territorial imperative. I guess one day, while some of the young men were working in the camp, Jones and I weren't in the camp at this time, we were out, and some of the young men were preparing to get the grounds ready for the Sundance. And they were doing a lot of work around there. They were putting up outhouses, you know, and stuff like that. They were cutting wood and getting things together and, you know, stockpiling the cookhouse. And all of a sudden, I guess a truckload of cowhands come into the camp. Roughly around 12 of them, and they drove in there, and they began to intimidate the young men that were there. One of the young men was sitting up on a power site, and he was doing a fast. And these guys came up with a camera and started videotaping him while he was on his fast. Another cowhand jumped out with a bull whip and cracked a bull whip, and said it was a good day to string up some red niggers. So guys threatened to burn down the council house. A couple guys went over and ripped off the door off the council house, the cookhouse, and stole the stove from inside, saying that someone had stole that from them, which was an outright lie. So one guy was there, I guess he pulled out a rifle, and they saw it as a direct threat, and they didn't know how many of the other guys had guns there. But they certainly came there with a message. They said they were going to, they came with a piece of paper telling Percy Rozek that he was evicted from the land there, and that he had to be out by June the 13th. Well, of course, the Sundance was already, all the preparations for the Sundance were well in, you know, ready, well underway, and nothing was actually going to stop that Sundance. It couldn't stop the Sundance. That had to be completed, because you couldn't just stop in the middle and look for somewhere else to start Sundancing.
Was this a government and police conspiracy, or simply a territorial dispute over cows infringing on sacred ground?
The planning process really started in May on the part of the governments and the RCMP. And this is something that the general public is not really that aware of yet, and it hasn't come out in the court process that I'm aware of. Now, it could possibly have come out without my knowing it, because I'm not at the court all the time. But through the documents that we've got, this disclosure documents from the RCMP, it's pretty clear that they began to put that whole process together in May, long before there was any problems at Gustafsen Lake. And in fact, everything was engineered. The business of the rancher coming in with his ranch hands and threatening the people in the camp and trying to force them out of the camp, all of that was engineered by the RCMP. I don't believe that rancher really wanted to have any part of that whole process, to tell you the honest truth. He knew, and so did the RCMP knew, that there was only one more year of the dances taking place at that particular location, and then they would be obligated, that's part of the process, to move to another location, which has been picked out, of course, by the spiritual people in North America, where the next spiritual process would take place. So they knew, the RCMP and the rancher knew, that they were only going to be there for one more year and they would be gone from there. But they also knew that the people in there, in that camp, had made it very clear that they were standing in their own land on unceded territory, unceded Shuswap territory, and that as far as they were concerned, that was their own land, that was their own territory, and that became a threat.
Even after the government employed well over 400 RCMP personnel, specially trained mercenaries called the emergency response teams. They had dogs, they had stun guns, they had bombs that they contrived out of tripwires to kill people moving through the perimeters they sent up. They brought in APC tanks. They used M16s, assault rifles. They used MP5 machine guns. They shot well over 20,000 rounds of bullets up at the people at Gustafsen Lake. And yet they couldn't kill anybody. They manufactured a number of incidents in order to justify the kill, because they realized that they had to justify this to the average human being out there. The RCMP and a so-called being law enforcement agencies upholding the principles of democracy and justice according to Canadian law. But the most scary thing that we saw there during this whole time at Gustafsen Lake, we saw the rise of nothing less than a fascist police state. And we saw the methods and mechanisms that they used and employed in order to justify an incursion into Gustafsen.
I'm sick to death of seeing things from tight-lipped collars and in mama's little shoulders. All I want is the truth. Just give me some truth now. I've had enough from watching scenes with schizophrenic, egocentric, paranoid prima donnas. All I want is the truth now. Just give me some truth.
Evidence from transcripts, witnesses, videotapes, and court documents that surface throughout the lengthy course of this trial portray a very different scenario than the accounts provided at the time. While at Gustafsen Lake, Dr. Clark applied for protection from the RCMP. However, court evidence has depicted an aggressive, coordinated, and unscrupulous campaign seemingly engineered by the RCMP.
Well, after I applied for protection to the police would take instructions. And that's the problem, you see. Since about 1880 in Canada, the legal establishment, that is, as a group, the lawyers and the judges and the police, literally spearheaded the premature, that is, no treaty of purchase, enabling treaty of purchase being made. The legal establishment itself spearheaded the invasion into the Indian territories. The lawyers went and opened up shop. They started doing land deals. They certified the titles to the settlers. They brought in the judges, and the settlers would start their farms, and the Indians would come up and say, hey, everybody's trespassing here, and we have a right and a remedy. And the police would be called in and arrest the Indians for threatening the settlers. And then the Indians would be given a lawyer. But you see, the lawyer was also trespassing and raising a family, and he would take the case before a judge who was trespassing and raising a family. And what the Indians found is the same thing that I'm finding, that when they stand up to say, my lord, you don't have any jurisdiction because this is still Indian country, they're held in criminal contempt of court, and they go to jail for a long time. There was a period when often Indians really going to jail really was a death sentence for persons of that culture. And now, when one reads the mortality rates for Native society in this country, the argument is not too onerous an argument to be made that the abridged lifespan in Native society, the horrible statistics of deaths from suicides and internecine violence are all a function of this gross and manifest injustice specifically a legal injustice, one perpetuated specifically by the legal establishment. The consequence is that the courts, who are the eminence grise behind all of this, without the courts making it happen, it simply wouldn't happen. They are aiding and abetting the genocidal process. Essentially, for 25 years, I have been trying to get the Canadian legal establishment to address some pretty straightforward points of law, really two and two makes four, black and white stuff. And as we get closer and closer to actually addressing it, the authorities tend to get more and more hysterical, because they really don't have a credible answer in terms of the law. The only thing they could do, if it mattered how one played the game, the only thing they could do is say, well, our ancestors made a mistake. Yes, this is the truth. The law does say that. So that aside, now that we've got the truth sorted out, we have a political conundrum here, which is a political problem. We must change this law to accord with modern times. But they won't do that. They're naughty children who are all caught with their hands in the cookie jar, and then one says, your hands are in the cookie jar, and to a man, the police and the lawyers and the judges all stand up and say, what cookie jar? There's no cookie jar here. And go to jail, you scandalous fellow, for suggesting there is a cookie jar. And they all agree on this.
The people that stood at Gustafsen Lake are part of a group of members of Aboriginal nations in British Columbia, who have decided that we are going to attempt to force the governments to deal with our legal position in the courts, and rather than to take on like continuous roadblocks and confrontations. I mean, that gets attention, but it doesn't really solve anything. So we decided we would use their own laws. And what we've said all along is, look, your laws are very clear, and they are in the Constitution. They're the highest laws of the land, and we insist that you live by your own laws, not by our Aboriginal laws. We have our own laws, which we intend to put back in place at some time in the future. But we're saying you people must live by your own laws. And that's the process that we were involved in, and that's the process that was going on at Gustafsen Lake. Now, it so happens that the legal minds in Canada are very aware and very familiar with those laws, and they know they're breaking their laws every day. And they know they broke their own laws when they took control of Canada and they imposed their jurisdiction on British Columbia and British Columbia Aboriginal nations, that in fact everything that they've done in British Columbia has been totally illegal. So what we're saying is that obey your own laws, then we'll sit down and we'll discuss how we're going to coexist.
Well, that's the whole point of the thing. From my perspective, just as a human being, I am, of course, concerned about my clients, and I'm concerned about the Native people as victims. But I'm concerned about the rule of law. It is utterly, unambiguously being trashed in the context where I suspect that the rule of law, if ever it's going to get trashed, probably gets trashed in the context of genocide. That is, that's the ultimate test. Canada is engaged in it, has been for some time. And the consequence of a country being engaged in genocide is that the rule of law simply does get trashed.
Here is a man that's exposing the fraud of the government, both provincial and federal, in Canada, as well as now exposing the fraud from the state and the federal levels in the United States, in the U.S. Here's a man that has been working for many Native nations, trying to confederate the nations through the use of the rule of law to validate the question of sovereignty, and more than anything else, as a freedom fighter and a person who is a great human being, he and his wife Margaret, who have suffered a lot in trying to help Native peoples against the status quo, against the power structure of the colonial forces within the Western Hemisphere here, who find his law very threatening, his truth very threatening. So with especially threatening when he finds Native peoples like myself, the Wolverine, and many others across the board, understanding very thoroughly how the law works from both worldviews. And so coming from that perspective, we pose a threat because we're exposing the fraud. And when we refuse to allow the fraud to reign, and we draw the line in the sand, and we draw attention to the fraud, to the theft of our lands and our resources through these so-called legalized institutions, then you become a threat to the power structure.
The situation, as I perceive it, is really very simple. The Canadian legal establishment, as I said, about 135 years ago, invaded the unsurrendered Indian territories. At the time they did it, it was in breach of the 1537 right and in derogation of the 1704 remedy. It was also misprision of treason and fraud under the Royal Proclamation of 1763, which was the then existing constitutional declaration upon this subject. And eventually, as it continued, would become falling breach of the Genocide Convention 1948, when it was enacted. So essentially, you have a legal establishment which is simply operating outside the parameters of the rule of law. And it exists in three components: police, judges, and lawyers. But it's really a unit. And so you don't have to allege a conspiracy that in this unit, A is talking to B is talking to C. They're all on the same journey, and they have been for 135 years. They really don't have to have wiretap evidence to get their act together. This is an old soft shoe that they've been dancing for a century.
The Crown has a duty to uphold the protections of Native peoples in unceded territories. Otherwise, they're violating their own proclamations of 1763. What most people don't seem to understand that in 1763, one of the main reasons why King George III validated this proclamation and wrote this proclamation, validating the right of Aboriginal peoples to maintain control of their territories and unceded territories, unmolested and undisturbed with the protection of the British Crown, was sort of an appeasement factor during that time, because Pontiac, a great war chief, was causing for the confederation of many native nations throughout the East, and at that time Eastern Coast and all out throughout Canada. And in the States, there was rising up of Native peoples uniting, and they were burning down British forts left and right, as well as French forts. And so subsequently, the Europeans at that time, the Crown understood that if the Native peoples ever rallied together and armed together and united and become one great force, they would have drove the Europeans back into the sea. So they understood that, so that there was really a major military force that they were looking at. And at that time, they were afraid that if the Native people, who are a very peaceful people by nature, are very evolved, sentient beings, but if the Native people got angry and brought their warrior societies together and formulated a massive military unity, that in fact there would be a major contentious force to have to deal with.
I want to tell you a little bit about the relationship between the Queen and the Indians from the Indians' perspective, at least from the traditional Indians' perspective, because my clients are not in any genocidal situation. In an occupied country, one will find a collaborating class and a resistance class. I tend to act for the resistance class. These are the Indians who are traditional. They're not being paid by any governments, and they are the ones who still are culturally in the grip of the old style. Well, part of that old style is a virtual religious belief in the relationship with the Queen, and it stems from the peace pipes and the smoke ceremonies that the Indians always went through with the monarchs of Great Britain. And in the native culture, their worldview, their religion, to smoke the peace pipe or to smudge involves the dispersal of the smoke and the atoms which carry the thoughts into the fabric of creation. And it, in that process, it is impossible to lie or to break any undertakings, because when the thoughts become integrated into the fabric of creation, if you breach them, it tears the fabric, and the result is catastrophe, literal catastrophe. In the native mythology and religion, the result can be the wiping out by fire, ice, literally natural catastrophe, that Mother Earth becomes, she can't abide this sort of business. And the native traditionalists feel that they have this kind of relationship with the British monarchy. It's, they are on an equal, sacrosanct, literally sacrosanct relationship.
We asked Dr. Clark to comment on how the British view this relationship and on responses he has received from applications made to Queen Elizabeth II in the United Kingdom.
Absolutely heartbreaking. The natives just don't understand it. They just keep coming back. They keep coming back to the Queen because they cannot, at least the traditional ones, cannot simply learn the lesson that the Queen is breaching this relationship. In terms of the rule of law, by the way, I did my doctorate on this particular issue in Scotland. In terms of the rule of law, there's no question whatsoever that the Queen is under a constitutional obligation not to legislate, but administratively to staff this court. And the petition to which you referred me was precisely a petition asking the Queen to staff, to carry out that administrative duty, to staff this court, before whom the Indians could then put this jurisdiction question. What happened was, I wrote to Sir Robert Fellowes, the Queen's private secretary, in closing the petition, and I got back the answer that the Queen doesn't meddle in Canadian affairs. And of course, I responded that, well, this is the Canadian Queen, this is the guardian of the Canadian Constitution, and she's not being asked to meddle in political affairs, she's not being asked to legislate, she's being asked to carry out a constitutional duty. Well, Sir Robert wrote back and explained to me that there is a political convention that the Queen will not, again, become involved in Canadian affairs, and that this must be taken to the Canadian courts. Well, I wrote to Sir Robert again, and I said, well, please advise the Queen that the culprit, the alleged criminal, is the Canadian courts. So it's the reason the natives are turning to the Queen is because since the 1704 order in council, the monarchy has been the failsafe to prevent genocide. You see, the problem, for example, with Hitler's Germany was there was no Queen. Or perhaps the Jews might have petitioned the Queen and she might have intervened or gone down trying. But fortunately, in theory, in Canada, the natives have this right of access to the Queen as a settled point of international constitutional law, that being the 1704 order. Nevertheless, Sir Robert comes back to me saying, political convention says the Queen will not respond. And I write back to Sir Robert and I say, I agree that political convention says that, but constitutional law says the contrary. So we have a classic conflict between law and convention. The Canadian Constitution 1982 makes it perfectly clear that Canada is a country premised upon the supremacy of the rule of law. So there can't be, in legal theory, a real conflict. The law simply must rule. But what I find is that Sir Robert rules, and the Queen simply closes the door.
Mother, mother, there's too many of you to cry. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you die. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Yeah. Father, father, we don't need to escalate. War is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate. You know we've got to find a way to bring some love.
At the time of contact, there were about 1.5 million Aboriginal people living in British Columbia. And of course, our people lived in only the best places to survive, which is along the rivers, where there are a lot of salmon and where you can grow things, and on the coast where there's a lot of seafood and where the timber is. Like all of the cultures that developed on the coast were very large communities, and they were a seagoing culture. They relied upon the sea for their survival. And of course, anyone that's lived by the sea knows that you could survive forever right out of the ocean itself. You wouldn't even have to worry about taking anything off the land. So that's where our communities were. Well, of course, they're the very same communities where non-Aboriginal people, as they moved into British Columbia, would want to settle down. And of course, gold, the gold rush in the 1840s, of course, is what brought the great onslaught of non-Aboriginal people into British Columbia. Prior to that, we were left pretty well to ourselves and left alone. It was just the Hudson's Bay Company and their trading posts that were existing in British Columbia. But what they brought with them, of course, was smallpox and other types of European diseases, which almost totally annihilated the Aboriginal people in this province. And I'll use the Haida Nation as an example. There were in excess of 80,000 Haidas living in Haida Gwaii and southern part of Alaska at the time that the smallpox epidemic hit here. And there were 80 some villages in Haida villages at that time. After the smallpox epidemic and various other kinds of things, like our people even died from whooping cough and measles and things like that, because these were totally foreign diseases to our people and they'd never been subjected to anything like that. TB, our people were still dying 20 years ago from TB. This is a strange illness to our people, and of course we built up no defense against these kind of diseases. So the end result was that by 1880, when they began to count how many Aboriginal people were in British Columbia, there were only something like 38,000 left from 1.5 million. They almost wiped us right out.
What we're talking about here is really an endangered species, and it is a really precious species. The native elders and the people who I'm working for are genuinely culturally different. If you put our cultural attributes on the ends of your fingers and you were to meet them, they just don't meet. They're the spaces in between the fingers, and they're precious, and there are very few of them, and they are dying. The young ones who are raised by their grandparents, who still have the language and are still that way. I lived on a reserve for 7 years, and I watched them, and every person in the native community had a friend, a relation, a cousin who had either committed suicide as a teenager. All the sweet ones, the gentle ones, the ones who couldn't make the transition to the other culture, drowned themselves in alcohol or killed themselves. And it is a genuinely diminishing resource, and it's a precious resource. I think we need them. And I don't know how long it can go on. The program of genocide has been operating full steam here in Canada for about 135 years. There aren't a whole lot of culturally native natives left, and it may be that within our lifetime, maybe within the next 10 or 15 years, there really won't be any. And so maybe it will peter up. The perfect crime will have been literally perfected.
And let's be truthful, the millions of peoples that have lost their lives in cold, violent, terrible deaths, and the blood that just saturates the earth in North America and all up and down Central and South America. As we're talking right now, people in Guatemala and El Salvador and the Amazon Basin, they're still being hunted down like animals and shot down and killed as we're talking. And people are being tortured and murdered, and theft of their land. So the savagery of the colonial forces has not stopped. It's not as apparent in North America, because North America has to continue to put on this facade that it is the democratic capital of the world, the human rights capital of the world. But the racism and the state of apartheid, really, against Native peoples is just as heavy. It's just as heavy now as it ever has been. And the quest for resources will always be the underlying economic factors that will continue to create the resistance between the aggressor and those that are suffering at the hands of the colonial nations.
One of the Gustafsen Lake defenders who has been most vocal in the legal position of unceded land and lack of jurisdiction is William Jones Wolverine Ignace. He has been labeled as dangerous, denied bail, charged with attempted murder, and wrongfully held in jail for over a year. He was interviewed at the Surrey Pretrial Center. Here he speaks on what it is like to be raised as a native on a reservation and how politicians subsequently control and manipulate your life.
Well, that's a lot of hardship, a lot of alcohol involved in there. People trying to forget what happened to us. A lot of people die of broken hearts, trying to make a living, scratch a living out of that little bit of land that was set aside for them in 1858. Before big, huge tracts of land taken away by the government, by trucks. this was done in 1864. Prior to that, there was a guy by the name of Douglas, Governor Douglas, that was going to make a treaty with the Shuswap people in 1858. There's posts that have been in South Thompson, and there's a cement plant. It's about 50 miles square. And then this was set aside for our people to, so that way we can coexist once the treaty was formed. 1864, trucks come in, reduce the size of our reserves, and give our people only 10 acres, while the white settlers get 160 for each member of their family. So what, when we have a racist attitude at that time, to me, that is more or less a form of genocide against our people. This is what we're trying to stop, the genocide what's happening today, only through legislation which the federal government has imposed on the Indian people. It's how the genocide is in effect amongst the people and on reserves. To me, that's not a reserve. I mean, to me, that's a concentration camp. We're put in concentration camps, and we have to stay there. That's not a reserve. Where else in the world do you see people right in time they're born, the time they die, you already have a number as soon as you're born, just like you have a brand. Who has that right to do this? Just like you put a stamp on, just like you, like a herd of cattle. Soon as you're born, you've got a stamp, and then that's the number you have to go by right till the day you die. Who gave these people the right to do this? This is what I want to know.
We interviewed Flo, the wife of Wolverine. She has had to contend with being displaced, having her family torn apart, her husband jailed, and both her son and husband prosecuted.
I've got true friends. True people that really believe in what we're doing. That gives me courage every day. And just by seeing Wolverine in prison, He's the one that gives me courage at times when I feel so down. But the people around me that are really supportive, that gives me a lot of, that helps me a lot. Gives me so much courage to stand every day and be proud of our people.
In addition to the tribulations and hardships which have resulted from the inconvenience of this trial, Flo has also suffered ongoing harassment.
People come to me and they say they hear people saying that they're going to, you know, get rid of Ian Jonesy. We've been told when I first moved down to Surrey, my brakes were cut, my fuel pump had a big nail in it. Other people's cars were tampered with, the wheels were all tampered with. While we were up there, you know, we didn't see nothing on the outside. I didn't think that there were so many people on the outside surrounding us. I wasn't afraid. I didn't feel afraid up there. But when we were coming out, and that's when I really, you know, was shocked and somewhat embarrassed too. To see all the military and the police, all with guns, big guns, and the APCs, and, you know, just for 18 people. And there's hundreds of them out there. And, you know, there was just four elders up there, and most of them were young. And it was shocking to see all that. You know, as soon as we got off the van, you know, there was guns pointing at us, people up in the trees pointing guns at us, people behind the rocks pointing guns at us. But I wasn't afraid. I was in shock to see. You know, I didn't think I'd see that much cops around. And the lies, you know, the people, the negotiators that went in to try to make us come out or something, but they told us lies.
On September the 1st, 1995, Dr. Clark made a formal agreement with Police Sergeant Ryan. The standoff would end. Sergeant Ryan was simply to have a letter mailed to the Attorney General of Canada, a condition that was agreed to. How was this agreement treated by the RCMP?
Well, it was breached, but every single time I made any kind of a transaction, an understanding, a promise with the police, it meant absolutely nothing to the police. This is really hard to comprehend. Like, I'm a sort of an average Canadian person raised to know that as a little boy, if I got in trouble, you go to the nearest policeman and he takes care of you. And I watch television, which says that, you know, the bad guys can do all they will, but eventually, if you get to the cop shop and you get to one sergeant and you tell him this is the truth, he'll hone in on that truth and you'll be okay. Well, the truth is absolutely irrelevant to the police. And what I found, for example, in the instance you've given, is this Sergeant Ryan and I worked out a reasonable solution, and together we drafted this letter, which would have been a letter saying the Attorney General of British Columbia and Canada agreed to submit the matter for third-party adjudication. And Sergeant Ryan and I both thought this was eminently sensible, and I typed it, and he dictated it, and we agreed, and we sent it off. Or at least I left it for him to send off. I signed it, and he was going to communicate. which he didn't do. He sent it to the Attorney General of British Columbia, apparently, who just dismissed it out of hand. It never got to the Attorney General of Canada, which, and that was the intent. And but we entered this familiar process of me corresponding and saying, well, you've breached your word again, and them saying, what cookie jar? Hand in the cookie jar? There is no cookie jar. It's the same thing. It meant nothing to the police. The truth means literally less than nothing. It's treated with contempt.
We interviewed Dr. Clark's wife, Margaret. Here she speaks about the treatment her husband received at the hands of the RCMP and judicial system. Are the shocking practices she claims routine? And is it possible they could be done here in the acclaimed civilized country of Canada in the 20th century?
He was wrestled to the ground. He was taken into the cells. He was put into a, there was just a hole in the floor for a bathroom and nothing, just stripped. He was, all the degradation, they'd really tried to break the spirit. They had a beeper outside the cell that he wasn't allowed every about 10 minutes, and it varied. He was wakened in the night for 3 days. So he was without sleep. He had no glasses, no pencil. Anything dehumanizing that could happen to him at that time. They even paraded him into the courtroom on the Monday morning with leg shackles, and they didn't take him in the back like they always do. They took him in the front through the media scrum of reporters. So everything, and then from there he went, was taken to the asylum for the criminally insane for a review, and Judge Friesen still maintains that the psychiatrist who certified him sane is in error.
The police, it's really hard to comprehend how much the police hate me and how much the judges hate me. And hate is an odd word. It's like conspiracy. It's not a word that lawyers use because it's such a hard word to prove. It's such a, almost a too deep emotion. But I found, for example, after one of the Court of Appeal hearings, I came down, I had raised the point, and there was a commissioner, who was a, like a sort of a police officer kind of person who monitors access to the courthouse. The Court of Appeal judge was standing there just chatting. And I walked by and I smiled and went to talk to him, just because I'd been practicing law for a long time, and regardless of what happens in court, out of court, the lawyers and the judges are generally friendly. And he looked at me, and his face went absolutely beet red, and his hand was shaking, literally shaking, and he turned his back to me and froze me out of the conversation. And it was the same kind of intense hatred that I get from the police.
During the siege, Bruce Clark, who's not well liked by the RCMP, apparently returned from the camp with the claimed physical evidence of RCMP members fabricating a shooting incident.
The police are engaged in a crime, and I attempt to apprehend the crime. Yes, and they do not want the criminals, which is to say, the judges and the lawyers and the police, do not want the fact of their crime pointed out. And since they cannot meet the point in terms of law, I mean, if they could, it would be done tomorrow. They would simply say, oh, okay, Clark, you've got four documents. This is where you made your mistake. But you see, they can't. This is what I did my doctorate on. It's independent and impartial scholars from Edinburgh, Aberdeen, Glasgow universities have, in a very disciplined fashion, examined each logical link in the chain that I am presenting. There aren't any weak links. I have no problem proving that the courts have no jurisdiction, and that their assumption that they do is prima facie misprision of treason and fraud and arguably complicity in genocide. That I have, believe me, no problem whatsoever. If I had a problem, the judges would put their finger on it. That's the problem. They can't.
It was necessary for the bureaucrats, both federally and provincially, to kill the message. And I believe they were ready to kill the messengers. It was definitely on their agenda. And they had begun to architect a number of incidents right from the very, very beginning. The RCMP began to make, to lie about alleged incidents that were occurring. Shootouts that were supposed to have been happening, trying to find some justification to go in there. to provoke an incident so that they could justify the use of massive force to go there and kill the occupants in the camp.
Dr. Clark wrote to the Attorney General of BC requesting that charges be laid against the RCMP for issuing what he termed was hate propaganda in labeling the natives as terrorists.
In the criminal code, a person cannot lay an information which is to commence legal process for certain specific crimes without the consent of the Attorney General. One of those crimes is hate propaganda. So for this reason, the RCMP, in my view, clearly had issued hate propaganda. They had branded these people who had occupied a defensive position in terms of common law remedy of self-help. They had branded them as terrorists, which is an entirely different matter. Terrorists are people who blow up school buses and take aggressive positions for political change. My clients were taking an entirely defensive position, not for any political change at all, but to assert an existing legal remedy. They did not want the law to change. They wanted the law to be respected. And their sole demand that as they issued from their redoubt under siege was precisely that, this third-party adjudication. In response to this, the RCMP branded them nationally in Canada, a great brouhaha, as terrorists. And by doing so, they discredited the whole legal approach.
All they could ever get, the people, the public could get every day, is what the RCMP spokespeople, in this particular case, Peter Schmier campaigns are our specialty monocue, as well as John Ward, were giving out one side of reportings of incidents that they basically were creating. They would create incidents and fabricate incidents, a number of incidents, to try to justify the use of force, the use of military force or arms in the camp to assassinate the people inside there. For instance, on September the 4th, they said that natives were stalking in the middle of the night, had fired down on one of the suburbans. And in fact, in later on in testimony that's come out of this trial, the current trial that's going on right now, that in fact it wasn't anybody stalking them that night, that it was a tree branch that hit the mayor. It wasn't a shot. And it was from their own forensic analysis. The RCMP had aerial surveillance going on 24 hours a day. And in that 24 hours of surveillance, there was going from August the 24th on. The government, during the time of this trial, has been able to produce tapes that corresponds to the 24 hours of surveillance. What most people don't realize that in these government tapes, you'll look at August the 27th, and you will see absolutely nothing that resembles a shootout with the Suburban on that day. As a matter of fact, there's nothing on tape. And you can see the whole day tape, everything, you see the same area, and you only see a few things that relate to the incident, but you never see the incident that was explained by these two cops that I believe completely fabricated a lie by their name of Mullen, Dyke, and Rocky, the ones that were supposed to have been shot in the with the flak jackets on. The testimony that they gave during the trial was that they were in the truck. And while they were in the truck, they come under heavy fire by the natives that ambushed them. They had to back the Suburban up. As they were backing up, Mullendike grabs his M16. He turns to the left. He starts firing outside the left into the bush to see if he can shoot back at whoever's shooting at him. He then fires across his partner out the window, and he starts shooting his M16 out the bush. And he's backing up 50 to 100 feet before he has to turn around. Of course, they are supposed to both been shot through the Suburban in the back door, through their seats, into their flak jackets. And that saved their lives. Well, of course, their testimony says that they were being shot from the front. And yet their bullets are coming in from the back, and they're backing up. So all of that testimony that they gave was definitely a lie. The other major incident was the incident of September the 11th. That morning, they said that afternoon, a negotiation team was supposed to come in. And the elders were scheduled in. They were driving in a blue van. And as they were driving in, at the same time they were driving in, the RCMP were watching over with the aerial surveillance. They were monitoring a red truck that was going to go out to get water for the others when they come in. As they're driving out the camp, one of the inspectors by the name of Kimball radios that they're coming in with guns. Two occupants getting in a car and they've got guns on them. Automatics, they're told. So as they're driving, they had already prepared the night before a place where they knew they have to go to the water hole. And so they set up and they dug a hole in a road and they lined it with plastic explosives. So that when the truck would drive over the plastic explosives, what would happen is that it would blow up the truck. And more than likely, there was enough detonation power to blow up and kill the occupants in the truck. Of course, they said they were only going to try to detain them so that they could arrest them. When if you look at the aerial surveillance of that day, you'll see that they actually, when they were driving over the truck with the dog in the back of the truck, they got into the truck with no weapons. It was just two people going to get water. As they drove over the truck, there was massive explosion, blew the hood right up off the truck. Right after that, you see an APC coming. It rams the front of the truck and rides up on top of the engine. Dog jumps out of the back of the truck, starts heading back towards the camp, bewildered, starts running. They pull out the APCs, they pull out their guns, sharpshooters on the side of the road. They put eight pieces of lead, they kill the dog on the side of the road. But the report for that day is that they jumped out, fired down on the RCMP, which was an outright lie by their own video, by their own aerial surveillance. But that was the justification for the RCMP. They spent over 20,000 rounds of bullets that afternoon trying to kill the occupants in the camp.